Good morning.
Morning.
Today's call to worship comes from the book of Colossians, chapter 3, verses 12 through 17. So as those who have been chosen of God, holy and beloved, put on a heart of compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience, bearing with one another and forgiving each other. Whoever has a complaint against anyone, just as the Lord forgave you, you, so also should you. Beyond all these things, put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ richly dwell within you, with all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with thankfulness in your hearts to God. Whatever you do in word or in deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to him, to God the Father. Amen.
Would you all take page 500 in your green book?
That's all I got.
All we want.
I'm not sure if they match up, so this might be a solo.
We'll sing or we'll sing.
Yep, sing what you got, and I'll sing what I got, and we'll all meet at the end. Hopefully, this is one of those songs that you speed up on, and I gotta, there's a lot of words, so I gotta make sure I'm not speeding up, it'll just be a blur of a mouse here. With the trumpet of the Lord so sound, the time will be no more. The morning brings its turns bright and fair. When the sea and the earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the Lord has called up yonder, I'll be there. When the Lord has called up yonder, when the Lord has called up yonder, when the Lord.
Thank you.
Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity to give back. Father, help us to be generous givers. Help us to be joyful givers and know that it's all to your glory and to your blessing. We pray, Father, that this would strengthen the church and go out to the community. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Before I begin with prayer, I brought some things downstairs to give away. There's a whole bunch of Christmas gift bags and two little organizers you put in your car if you want to put groceries or something. Anyway, okay. Mary, what's her last name?
Jackson.
Mary Jackson, that's right. She had her corduroy carotid artery. That worked out fine, but she has another serious problem with her rectum is falling and everything is falling, and she can't go to the bathroom. She's home though, so she must be on liquids.
All goes well. She's scheduled for 13th December for that surgery.
For what?
For that surgery.
Okay. That's a long time to wait.
Four in a row.
She's in a lot of pain from that.
Goodness gracious.
Who is this lady anyway?
This is Faye's sister.
That girl's sister.
Faye's sister.
Mary. Mary Jackson. I don't know why Ruby cold iron. Ruby is fine. Why is Ruby on here? Did I ask for her? She's doing just fine. I'll take her off. Gary cold iron, he had a double knee replacement and he's doing very well, so he can go off. Any other new things?
Put my niece on there, Brenda K9. She's having surgery tomorrow. Hip replacement.
Brenda K. What's her last name?
Knight.
Oh.
K-N?
I-G-H-T.
Has what surgery?
Hip surgery.
Hip replacement?
Hip replacement.
Glad to see Linda here. We were kind of.
You feeling better, Linda?
Better than I did last week.
Yeah, you have to be better.
I don't even see you. I think you're already off, right?
No, she's
left side.
Because I took a text Dan to tell him that you were home and doing all right. I ask continued prayer for Kim, my stepdaughter, Henry's daughter. Besides all her health issues with the myasthenia gravis, she's going through a lot of problems with her insurance. In Florida, they're leaving. The insurance companies are leaving because of all the tornadoes and her. She said that she had one claim, I think it was, I don't know, back in 16. It was a tornado inside of a hurricane. I never heard of that. But anyway, she needed a new roof. I helped her with that, but the insurance company just canceled her.
They didn't pay her claim at all?
Pardon me?
They didn't pay her claim?
Yeah, she got that claim, but now, that was 4 or 5 years later, that, they've canceled it. I think they're leaving the Florida. So she has to find another insurance company. And with being turned down, you know, maybe that might be a problem, so just pray for that she can find something.
I know it's very expensive, it is here, but it's even worse there.
I would imagine it is.
Sue and Sydney, they just didn't buy insurance on their house down there. And I mean, if anything happened, which they had to put a roof on their house.
Yeah.
They just had to pay for it themselves.
What about Tildy? She have anything about, say anything about insurance?
No. She's 76 today.
Oh, today her birthday?
76, wow.
I don't know why, I was thinking it was in October for some reason.
Anything else new?
Well, Brittany just sent the
Oh, yes, yes.
Christmas boxes she took them, you know, to Bailey's, so if everybody, anybody that didn't send their money in, you know, for the postage, don't forget to do it.
Yeah, how many boxes did we get?
I don't know, 14 sticks in my mind, but I really don't know if that's right.
Okay. And also, Brittany and Louie are up in Chicago by now, right?
They should be, yeah.
And she said that, Chris was going to be coming home pretty soon, within the next month, this month?
Yeah, probably, they were gonna try to get him, 2 or 3 more weeks of therapy. And then he'd be going home, to Tennessee, and they're gonna stay with Katie's mom.
Okay.
For I don't know how long, 'cause her house doesn't have stairs everywhere like Chris's house does. And, somebody started a GoFundMe page for Chris, but I don't know much about it.
A what?
A GoFundMe page for Chris on the computer. Because, you know, he's not gonna work for a long time, and, there's things that, you know, he's gonna have to have and need.
Is he on a walker or a cane?
No, no, they put him in a harness and put a treadmill like under him and two ladies like move his legs, he can't do that, you know.
Well.
It's to try to wake up the nerves, I think, in his body. So they really work hard with him. But he'll probably be doing therapy at home 5 days a week, or going somewhere to get therapy.
But he's gotta be able to at least use a walker.
No, he doesn't, no.
I mean, when he's home.
No, no, he can use a wheelchair.
Oh, okay.
That's why they're going to his mother-in-law's instead of his house, because of the stairs.
Okay.
And there would be nobody with him, 'cause Katie would be working, you know, she's a school teacher, until summertime come, or spring break. He needs somebody with him. It's gonna be a new way of life.
Yeah. Anything else? Lord God, as we come into your presence, knowing that you are a loving God, knowing that no matter what we go through, you already have known about what's going to happen before it happens. So help us to trust you, because you are the Father. You take care of us. Help us, Lord, when we have to deal with difficult situations and illnesses. We pray for Brenda Kay Knight, having hip replaced, I believe she said tomorrow. I pray for the doctors, guide their hands. Thank you for Tildy and her life. I down there in Florida. Every day is a new adventure with hurricanes. Remy and Louie in Chicago with Chris, and we have given the strength. I know he's working hard to overcome this. And I know he trusts you to get him through this. That one day he will be walking on his own. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that you love us so much. We pray for Dan as he brings us the message. It's what you have given him, put on his heart. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Starting Christmas music again. Is it that time? It's hard to play. Well, anyway, that's my problem. Okay. Father, we thank you for your word. Thank you each week that we have this time that we can come together and look at your scripture. Hopefully, Father, we will grow closer to you. We pray that you would fill us with your spirit right now and open our hearts and our minds to all that you have for us to offer. And we thank you, Lord. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. I need to fill in the middle. I feel like I'm like a COVID crowd. There's like nothing in the middle of everything.
We heard you had COVID.
Yeah, certainly spread out, only on the fringe in the back. So, all right, we're moving along in Ruth. We hit chapter 2 last week. It brought in a new character into the story of Boaz. And we see that Boaz was a very rich, he's very powerful, but also a very godly man. He blesses the people that are around him. He takes care of his employees, makes sure that they're well taken care of. And the people that are just around him, he just brings blessings. And this makes him being obedient to Leviticus 19, where if you owned land and you were harvesting whatever it was, don't go back and scrape up every little thing. Leave stuff for the people that are in need, the poor, people that were traveling that would become by if they didn't have food. They could go to a field and collect some of what was left over. So this is God's plan to take care of people. And the situation where if you have all of this land and you have all of this riches, you're blessing others. He's showing them to be generous and to be a blessing to other people. And when I was going through this and just thinking about being a blessing, and the time that we're around Thanksgiving, there was years ago, Angie and I were gonna volunteer at like a soup kitchen, and they had one in South Bend. So she started calling just to see, you know, where could we help out? So it's getting close to Thanksgiving, and they said, we don't need help. We have too many people. And the problem is, they said, we have too many people from Thanksgiving to Christmas. And then after that, it's crickets. We have nothing. So people come in for this one big thing, whether they're trying to get themselves in the Christmas spirit, or if it's like, oh yeah, Thanksgiving, I'm going to help people out. But it's those other months of the year is where they need help. And that's as us Christians, we have to be like Boaz. It's like blessing people continuously. If we have, everything we have is because the Lord has given it to us, and we need to be generous and be blessing people throughout the year. And if we follow Leviticus 19, not only are we supposed to be generous, but those who are in need, that it's like the Lord puts it out there. It's almost like salvation. Here's the gift, come and get it. So they would leave food in the fields, come and get it. It's there for you. So the Lord is providing, but there has to be something on both sides. The Lord has given us much so that we can give much. But if we're in need, the Lord also has it there for us. We have to get it. So we see that Boaz notices Ruth in the fields working, and her testimony, which becomes a big part of this whole story, is Ruth's testimony of what kind of a person that she is. He's heard what she's doing, how she is not only honoring her mother-in-law, but honoring the Lord. She's honoring God. Even though she came from a pagan land, basically she would have been a pagan too, but she recognized the God of Israel as the one true God, and she was honoring him. And this is how her testimony goes before her and opens up, when we see as it goes through, as we go through the story, that it opens a lot of doors for her because of her testimony, because of who she is, and because of how she is honoring the Lord. Now we see that there's a need here. Obviously, Ruth is in need, Naomi's in need, and where there's a need, that's an opportunity for God to work in our lives, and an opportunity for us to rely on Him. There is this God-shaped hole in our lives that we have. That's the only thing that's going to satisfy our spirits or our souls, is that having God in our lives. And then we see, you can look at society, look at the people we know that try to fill that hole with anything and everything else. Some people try to stay so busy that they don't have to think about it, or I need more stuff, or I've got this, or family, or crazy Christmas decorations. That one hit close to home. But you know, people get overboard, and then we run into the situation of how dare you bring Jesus into Christmas. And is just trying to use anything in our lives, whether it's our job, whether it's our family, and trying to make that what our point of life, or what's going to make us feel complete, but it has to be the Lord. That's what's going to make us complete. And think of all the people. There's this need here, but sometimes that need to cause us to rely on the Lord. How many people throughout the scriptures did God have to break them before he could use them? Look at the story of David. We look at Paul. He had to be broken before God could use him. And God will use that in our lives. He'll give us this much, and we think we can handle it. It's like, okay, how about this? You're not relying on me. You're trying to do it on your own. The Lord would break entire nations because they weren't coming to him. They weren't following him. That's what happened in Bethlehem. That's why there was a famine there. They had turned away from him. They weren't relying on him. So he gave them more than they could handle, so they would have to rely on him. So there's this need there. So whether it's God providing for us in Boaz's situation, he was to be a blessing to somebody else. He was supposed to be taking care of other people. The Lord wants to be with us through our problems. He wants to work with us. There was never the guarantee of an easy path. That's nowhere in the scripture that anybody has an easy path. Anybody that's followed the Lord and tried to be obedient to him has had a rough road to go. But he wants to be with us through the storm. He doesn't sit back and just encourage. He's not the cheerleader. God is not the cheerleader saying, you can do this, you can handle it, you keep going, keep going. No, he's like, I will be there with you, and we're going to work this out together. You're going to have a problem, and we're going to do this together. We need to look to him and to rely on him. As we go through this, the scriptures, and always kind of, will always point to Jesus, and it will always point to the gospel. So now as we start sliding into chapter 3, we see this even more of how this story kind of mirrors Jesus and the church. And this is not just a developing love story between Boaz and Ruth, but this is a parallel of Jesus and the church and, say, our relationship to Christ himself. Boaz is going to be the kinsman redeemer here, who would buy back what was lost, what was taken, and restore it. And in this case, he's saving the lives of Naomi and Ruth, who had nothing. When they left Bethlehem, everything that they had needed to be sold down to the bare minimum, and then they went to Moab, and on their way back, there was nothing for them to come to. And it never really says where they were sleeping or where they were setting up. I don't know if they had a camp or if somebody was letting them stay in a barn or whatever. It never says where they were sleeping or where they were living. So as we start off chapter 1 of verse 3, it says, Naomi, her mother-in-law, said to her, my daughter, should I not seek rest for you that it may be well with you? Okay, so I read that. And I read it again. I read it again. I was like, what does that even mean? Should I not seek rest for you that it may be well with you? So I've read that so many times. I'm like, what's the wording? What's going on? This is why we have other translations. Because that makes no sense. So that was the ESV, which I usually use, but that was just weird. So here's the NIV. One day, Ruth's mother-in-law, Naomi, said to her daughter, I must find a home for you where you will be well provided for. Ah, there it is. You need a home, and you need somebody to provide for you. Ah, much easier. You need a husband, you need a home, you need a family. That's what she's telling her. Much easier to understand. So she needs to get a husband. So there was, at the time, there was a thing called the Levirate marriage, which would be an obligation to the brother to marry the widow, his brother's sister. It's called Levirate marriage. There was no evidence that Elimelech had brothers to marry Naomi. Ruth was a pagan, so she wasn't actually a Jew, so she wasn't, this wasn't even a place for her to be married. Naomi wasn't looking for a husband. She was like, I'm done. She wasn't looking for a husband, but she wanted to provide for Ruth. She wanted to make sure that Ruth was taken care of, because working in the fields and probably setting up a camp somewhere, it's like, this shouldn't be your life. So she says, now Boaz, with whose women you have worked, is a relative of ours. So tonight, you will be winnowing barley on the threshing floor. So this is another one of those things I'm looking at it and like, you know, you hear a lot about winnowing and threshing floors and all that. What is it? So I looked it up. So winnowing. Okay, so what they had? They had this barn that had two walls on it. So that it would allow the wind, when the wind would blow, it would go through the areas that were open. They would bring whatever grain they were going, and they would step on it, or they would roll rocks across it, they would hit it to break the outer shell. They said sometimes they would use animals, they would drag stuff across it. It would crack the shells, and they have these big fork things that look like rakes, and you throw it up in the air, and then the wind would come through and blow all the chaff out. So all the shells and the stuff you don't want to eat, when you're throwing it up in the air, it would go this way. You throw it up in the air and it'd go this way. So you're getting, what's falling, which would be heavier, would actually be the seeds that you're going to want to eat. So the winnowing, the threshing floor, they would have these slats, little gaps in between, so when it hit, that would fall through. So now you've just winnowed it, and then it threshed, and then you have your grain. So,
easy, right?
Yep, easy stuff. It's hard work because you get these big, you know, like those big plastic rakes, but they're just made out of wood and whatever, and they just throw it up in the air, throw it up in the air, and you're sitting there all day just whipping the stuff up in the air. No safety goggles, no OSHA, nothing going on there. So they're doing this all day. So this is hard work, so you're going to be tired. So she says, she's telling Ruth, wash, put on perfume, get dressed in your best clothes, then go down to the threshing floor, but don't let him know that you are there until he has finished eating and drinking. Well, he's working hard all day. They go off, they have a meal. We saw that in chapter 2, that he would take his men, that he would provide a lunch for them. So this is probably what's going on at the end of the day. So she tells her, hey, get cleaned up. So here's a story I found. No, I got a bunch on the bed. So anyway, they didn't have access to water like we do now. So it wasn't like you were bathing every day. It wasn't like, oh, I'm going to take a quick shower and then go down to the threshing floor. Not happening. So I found this story about in the 1500s, people, this was probably Europe, wouldn't bathe but once a year. So when you get bathed once a year, they would bathe usually in May. So they would have this tub of water, and how it would go would be the man of the house and the men under him, like the father, the sons, then the mother, daughters, and they would go down the line of small kids, down to the babies. So by the time all these people have bathed, the water's pretty nasty. So when you go in there, that's where they come up with, don't throw the baby out with the bath water, because the water's so nasty you could lose the kid in there. So you bathed in May, but you notice there are traditionally June weddings. So everybody's pretty clean in June still. So you would have June weddings and the tradition of carrying a big bouquet of flowers to cover up your stink. So, whether that applies to Ruth, I don't know, but next time you go to the wedding, think of that. So, basically, she's telling her, get cleaned up, wait till things calm down, that's threshing floor, everybody's getting ready to go to bed. So, when he lies down, note the place where he is lying, and then go uncover his feet and lie down. He will tell you what to do. I will do whatever you say, Ruth answered. So she went down to the threshing floor and did everything her mother-in-law told her to do. So she's going in and lying down at his feet. He doesn't really say whether he was sleeping or not. Most likely he was by the time that she got to him. She said to uncover his feet and then just lay there. This is a showing of submission. And actually at the time, this was a courtship. This was actually something that people would do. So this was a courtship. I surrender to you. And Naomi tells her, he will tell you what to do after this. And with the thought of Boaz, the picture of Jesus and Ruth, it becomes Jesus in the church, us individually. She lays down at his feet in submission is where we need to be with Christ. And if we look at the story, Ruth is laying down at the feet of the Redeemer. He was going to be the Redeemer, and she puts herself in submission to him. And the scriptures show a lot of different pictures of being under somebody's feet and being in submission. In Psalms 110, it says, I will wait and I will make your enemies your footstool. They will be in submission to you. In Genesis 3, the serpent, I will crush his head and he will bruise the heel under the feet. So if we are going to call ourselves, if we call ourselves Christians, if we call ourselves followers of Christ, we need to be surrendered to him. We need to do what he tells us to do. It's like she's telling her, Ruth here. He will tell you what to do. Our culture doesn't like submission. We don't like being told what to do. Not to be told, Bob Dylan says you're going to serve somebody. I won't do the whole song, but you may serve the devil or you may serve the Lord, but you're going to serve somebody. And we put ourselves in submission to some degree every day, whether at work, we're at work or whatever we're doing in family situations, there's always, so we're having to submit somewhere. We need to submit to Jesus. Even just calling him Lord gives him a position in our lives, a position of authority. Are we submitted to him? To be in submission, we're going to do what he tells us to do, and then we're going to be fruitful. And if we're fruitful, we're living the way that the Father wants us to. But do we ignore that small voice that tells us, you should do this, don't do that, stop doing that, don't do that? So it's whether we are to do something or not to do something, that's a daily decision that we have to make to whether we're going to submit to Christ. Are we going to submit to the Holy Spirit that's prodding us and guiding us in the direction? So when Boaz had finished eating and drinking, he was in good spirits. He went over to lie down at the far end of the grain pile. Ruth approached quietly, uncovered his feet, and lay down. So if it's kind of cold and somebody uncovers your feet, eventually you're going to figure it out. Your feet are going to get cold. You're going to wake up like, what's going on with this blanket? So that's where she's at. She uncovers his feet. In the middle of the night, something startled him. He turned and discovered there was a woman lying at his feet. He says, who are you, he asked. Now this made me think. Naomi told her to put on her best clothes. And she goes in, he's like, who are you? It's dark out. She got all dressed up and he can't even see her. Things to consider. She says, I am your servant, Ruth. Spread the corner of your garment over me, since you are a kinsman redeemer. He says, the Lord bless you, my daughter. This kindness is greater than which you showed earlier. You have not run after younger men, whether they are rich or poor. So Ruth has not shown interest in any of the men that are around. There's a lot of men because they're harvesting, so there's a lot of men at different financial abilities, but she wasn't following after any of the other men. And he said, bless you, because she's now, okay, she's taking care of Naomi, but now she's putting herself in a position to be obligated to this family for the rest of her life, because she's putting herself almost in a proposal. I propose marriage to you, that she's going to be a part of this family forever. She's left her home, left her people, the former gods that she had, and she's going to be a part of what's going on here. He says, and now, my daughter, don't be afraid. I will do for you all you ask. All my fellow townsmen know that you are a woman of noble character. Her testimony comes up again. All of the men in town, all the townsmen know you are a woman of noble character. So that's again from chapter 2 to chapter now. Do we think about our own testimony, and what do people know of us? A lot of these, all these people don't know her personally, but what they do know of her is that she is a woman of noble character. She is honorable. Although it is true I am near of kin, there is a kinsman redeemer nearer than I. So with this, there would be only a couple of reasons why he would already be checking out if there's somebody else that's to take the responsibility of Naomi and Ruth. One, he's like, geez, I don't want this obligation for the rest of my life. But the one that's probably more to the point is that, he's had some interest in Ruth already. He's been extra kind to her, making sure that she has more than enough food, that she's taken care of. He feeds her when she's there. So there might be some sort of a feeling that he has towards her already, that he would be willing to take her as his wife. He says, stay here for the night, and in the morning, if he wants to redeem, good, let him. But if he is not willing, as surely as the Lord lives, I will do it. Lie here until morning. So he's going to check it out. He's going to find this other person, start putting this in process. You're closer. Do you want this obligation? If you don't, I'm going to do it. So she lay at his feet until morning and got up before anyone could recognize. And he said, don't let anyone know that a woman came to the threshing floor. So he said, bring me the shawl that you were wearing and hold it out. And when she did so, he poured in 6 measures of barley and put it on her. And then she went back to town. Well, six measures of barley is about 60 pounds. So he loaded up her shawl with that, and it says he put it on her. So she's probably got this 60-pound sack on there. And I just think about when I go to get chicken food. And I've got that 50-pound. I just go to the back of the store, just throw it on my shoulder, and walk through the store, which is okay. And I can make it up there and go through if the line is short. So I see if I check the line before I get up there to make sure that, and I run for the back and get up there before anybody else gets in line so I can pay for my chicken food with my 50-pound bag on my shoulder. But usually I get some guy get up there who's going to pay for his bill with nickels. So we got to sit there and count them out on the counter while I'm slowly sinking into the floor with a bag on my shoulder. So here's Ruth with a 60-pound bag of barley on her back. So when she went to her mother-in-law, she says, how did it go? Then she told her everything that Boaz had done and added, he gave me 6 measures of barley, saying, don't go back to your mother-in-law empty-handed. Then Naomi said, wait, my daughter, wait until you find out what happens, for the man will not rest until the matter is settled today. So when we go through this whole story up to this point, 3 chapters that we've got, a huge thing, our testimony. What do people know of us? They don't have to know us personally. What do they know about us? Are we honorable? Are we a good character? Are we followers of the Lord? And the huge theme from this particular chapter is, are we surrendered to Christ? Are we submitted to our Lord? And this little point that Naomi comes up, wait for him. He's going to take care of everything, and he's going to make sure that the matter is settled, but wait. Wait on him. He's going to take care of it. We don't want to end up, well, like Abraham. We don't want to get ahead of the Lord and make a mess of things. She says, wait, and it'll be taken care of. And we need to submit to the Lord, and we'll be fruitful in our lives. and we'll be living as the Father would have us. We're honoring God with all our lives and all that we do. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for the lesson that we have here. Help us to submit to you each and every day. And with each and every decision, Lord, help us to be submitted to Jesus, to follow the guidance of the Holy Spirit, and to live and to honor you with all that we do. And we thank you, Father. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. As we do the last song, somebody doesn't have the relationship with Christ that they'd like to, or membership, or baptism, or whatever you may want to talk, you can come forward and pray.
Family and friends, may we find a world of love and peace. Amen.